For all Keep the circle.
Yeah, beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. Well, good morning, all souls. Welcome. Well, y'all looking really good to me. Hey, I'm Assistant Minister Randy Lewis, and I'm joined on the chancel today by one of our pastoral care ministers, Reverend Doug Inhofe. And we're so excited to be with you in worship this morning on this St. Patrick's Day. Now, someone said, where's your green, Randy? Doesn't this shirt look green? It's all I had, folks. And welcome to those who've joined us online, our online viewers, and everywhere, members watching from all over the world. If you're on Facebook or Zoom, please drop your prayer requests, your joys and concerns into the chat so that in a moment we can light a candle for you and hold space for you here in the sanctuary. Now, if you're a first-time guest with us today, we invite you to meet one of our ministers and a member of our welcome team after the service in the library just outside the sanctuary doors to the left. It's a drop-in meet and greet with refreshments and a chance to answer your questions and to connect with others. So if you're new, just drop by and say hello. Also, fill out the Connect card found in the pew back in front of you and place it in the offering plate when it comes around. It's a way for us to stay connected with you. And for those online, please consider staying for our after-service coffee hour conversations immediately after the service. Now, I invite you to stand as you are able as Reverend Inhofe comes with our invocation and covenant.
This is indeed a day that God has made. Let us then rejoice and be glad in it. And let us count our many blessings. Let us be grateful for the capacity to see, hear, feel, and understand. Let us be grateful for the incredible gift of life. And let us be especially grateful for the ties of love which bind us together, giving dignity, meaning, worth, and joy to all our days. Please join us in our covenant that's printed in your order of service. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. Welcome to All Souls, where we love beyond belief.
Thank you. Our chalice is lit today by Everywhere member and current Board of Trustees member, Jeannie Lee. It's going to be a recording. Thank you.
Forget your perfect offering. Just sing a song that you can sing. There is a crack in everything. That's how the light, that's how the light gets in. That's how the light, that's how the light gets in.
Good morning. Our story this morning is called Beauty in the Brokenness. Reiko balanced the ceramic bowl in her tiny hands as she carried it to the kitchen. It was her mother's favorite blue bowl with tiny white blossoms painstakingly painted in on the inside. Her mother only brought it out on special occasions, alongside the gold kintsugi platter her father had created, and Reiko loved to run her fingers over the slightly worn edges as she listened to stories about her family in Japan, dreaming of all the hands through which this bowl had passed. Her favorite story was when her family had found each other after they had been separated during the war. Their joy at being reunited after being so broken-hearted was tangible even to her. Today was her mother's birthday, which Reiko thought qualified as a special occasion. The 5-year-old girl climbed the cabinets and brought out the dish all on her own, and she couldn't wait to fill it with her mother's favorite treats. But just as she was about to place it on the table, Reiko's foot caught on the edge of the kitchen rug and she stumbled and the bowl slipped from her fingers and crashed against the tile floor. Now it lay in shards at her feet and Reiko sank to her knees, gingerly picking up the pieces as she cried. A warm hand rested on her shoulder. Blurry through the tears, Reiko saw her grandfather's wrinkled face and kind eyes staring down at her. "I tried to be so careful. I just wanted to do something special for Mama's birthday. And now it's broken, and I can't fix it." "No," her grandfather's voice soothed her, "but I know someone who can. I'll help you pick up the pieces." They set each piece on a tray and carried them out to the garage where her father worked on a project. Her face paled with fear, worrying that her father would be upset that she had broken her mother's favorite bowl. Instead, he smiled at her and wrapped his daughter in a hug. Then he picked up the broken pieces and examined them. "What have we here?" "I broke Mama's bowl," Reiko explained with a quiver in her lip. "Well then," her father spoke, rolling up his sleeves, "we will fix it. It won't be the same as it was before, but perhaps it will be even better." Reiko watched in wonder as her father, a talented artist, mixed a gold lacquer with a few scoops of rice flour to make an adhesive, and he placed the broken shards of the bowl together with the glue. She watched in amazement as the bowl took shape, gold gleaming from the cracks. Her father had been right. Somehow it was more beautiful than it had been in the first place. "This technique is called kintsugi in Japan," her father explained as he worked. "It is believed that when broken items are repaired with gold like this, that the flaw becomes a unique piece of the object's history, and the uniqueness adds to the beauty." "I've never seen anything so beautiful, but won't Mama still be mad?" Her grandfather, who had been watching from a nearby stool, shook his head. "There will be things in our lives that break, no matter how careful we are, just like this bowl. But that doesn't mean they cannot be fixed. What was once broken can become something beautiful. I invite our children to come to Sunday school where we can discuss how we can mend the broken things in our lives and possibly make them even more beautiful than they were before."
Thank you. As our choir comes forward, I wanted to give you some background information about the piece you're about to hear. The piece is composed by Zenaida Stewart Robles, an award-winning Black American female composer, vocalist, and teacher. In this haunting and provocative piece, the composer has utilized words from actual protest signs. And one of our All Souls Chamber Choir members said about this piece, it takes the promise of a young and battled nation surviving the external trials of war and pits them against the modern internal struggles of a maturing nation living up to its own ideals. At All Souls, our theme is brokenness this month, and broken fragments of our national anthem insists that we take stock of where we are and that we consider where we need to go.
Thank you.
Wow. 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 Feeling kind of special today. It's the chamber choir and Cynthia Simmons Taylor and the adult choir. Y'all in for a treat today. He didn't know that was all that was happening, did you? Yeah, so thankful. At this moment, we gather with open hearts, minds, and spirits, embracing the care and concern we share for one another. It is in these times of challenge and shadow that we find that glimpse, that guiding light, a beacon of hope's resilience and love's boundless grace. So together we navigate life's transitions through moments of joy and through times of sorrow. Today we light a candle for member Tanya Moreno and for Tanya's mother, Julia Moreno, who is undergoing treatment for a brain bleed. And we light a candle for Joy and Gerald Davis, who sponsored the Chancel Flowers today because of their anniversary this month. I invite you now to name aloud someone you wish to be included in this sacred moment. I light a final candle for all the names spoken and those unspoken, but yet remain in our hearts. If you've lost a loved one in this past year, or if this Sunday is the closest to the anniversary of that loved one's death, I invite you now to stand for a brief moment of silence before the prayer. Please be seated. Please join me in prayer in the name of that which is to each of us of ultimate concern. In the spirit of life and love and laughter, let us consciously lay aside today our often reflexive thoughts that presuppose so much, that divide and break us into so many pieces, that keep us from honoring the common hopes and dreams and needs of all humans. And in doing so, let us, in whatever way is our own personal congenial way, to reveal ourselves to the world with charity, with humor, with words that heal, words that transform, words that invite a smile in someone, or a thanks, or simply relief for being accepted by another. In the name of that which is to each of us of ultimate concern. Amen.
When I breathe in, I breathe in peace? When I breathe out, I breathe out love. When I breathe in, I breathe in peace. When I breathe out, sing it with me now. When I breathe in, I breathe in peace. When I breathe out, I breathe out. When I breathe in,
would you help me welcome Cynthia Simmons Taylor?
More I look, the more I find, there's no perfect heart like you see on a Valentine. The more I see, the more I notice, everybody is a little bit broken. Everybody is a little bit broken. It's all right.
It's all right.
Everybody is a little bit broken. It's all right.
It's all right to be
broken. Spreading those ashes all around. Love is a flame, it never goes out. Look up in the sky, see the rising smoke, and everybody is a little bit broken. Everybody is a little bit broken. It's all right.
It's all right.
Everybody is a little bit broken. It's all right.
It's all right.
Yeah, a little bit broken. It's all right.
It's all right to be
broken. 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 I'm a little bit broken. David, he's a little bit broken too. Even Rick, he's a little bit broken. I'll bet you're a little bit broken. Mm-hmm. Oh, a little bit broken, yeah.
It's all right.
Everybody, everybody is a little bit.
It's all right.
Oh, just a little bit broken. It's all right.
It's all right.
Yeah, just a little bit broken, yeah.
It's all right.
Everybody is a little bit broken, broken,
it's all right.
Broken. Everybody is a little bit broken, yeah.
It's all right.
Everybody is a little bit broken. It's all right.
It's all right to be
broken.
Yeah. So you know where I got the title of this sermon from, right? It was taken from the Wood Brothers song, Little Bit Broken. And I like the lyrics. The ones that stand out for me is that the more I live, the more I know I should wear my scars like medals of gold. Everybody is a little bit broken. And it's all right to be a little bit broken. Yeah. A true story. The year was 1998, and Rita Bass Coors of the Coors Beer family was attending an auction for the Hospice of Metropolitan Denver. Going once, going twice, sold for $7,000, the auctioneer announced the winning bid as his gavel hit the table. Rita was elated. She had just won a unique porcelain mask hand-painted by the beloved late singer John Denver. She could hardly wait to take it home and add it to her collection of John Denver memorabilia. As the auctioneer hands her the covenant mask, it slips from her grasp and, to the horror of those in attendance, falls to the floor, shattering into dozens of broken pieces. What once held great value was seemingly brought to nothing in an instant. Now, I would have asked for my money back. But she didn't do that. Even though $7,000 was probably more like 7 cents for a Coors heiress. Just saying. But Rita simply picked up the pieces and took them home and placed the broken pieces around a memorial she had constructed for John. So our theme this month, as you may be able to gather, is brokenness, which I define as the condition in which something is so badly damaged that it ceases to function correctly. Some of us still have that childhood memory of the time when our favorite toy broke beyond repair. Then, as we grow up, we realize that just like inanimate objects that can be broken into many pieces, our lives can be broken too. Physically, emotionally, spiritually, relationally. Some say we're born into a world full of broken things, a broken world full of broken things, broken backs, necks, and bones, broken windows, birds with broken wings, people with broken spirits, broken hearts, and broken homes. And when I speak of broken people, these broken people make up broken families, broken organizations, and broken societies. They establish broken systems, thus proliferating brokenness, which perpetuates further divisions, inequalities, injustices, animosity, and deeper suffering. When we look at it, divisions and brokenness often lead to more divisions and still deeper states of brokenness. And someone ought to say amen to that. As a minister, I am often invited into people's lives during their most challenging moments of brokenness, times of loss, addiction, abuse, illness, fractured relationships, or some other hardship. Either as a result of our own decisions or from factors beyond our control, every one of us at some point faces moments of vulnerability, disappointment, and failure. In 2 Corinthians 12, 7 and 10, the Apostle Paul writes of having a thorn in the flesh. Now, we don't know what illness he had, but we know that he prayed for healing. But despite pleading with the divine to take it away, what he heard the divine say was, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness." So even Paul himself, who wrote most of the New Testament, experienced brokenness. So I guess indeed everybody's a little bit broken. It may be impolite of me to ask, but just how broke are you? Well, if looks were an indication, I'd say you're not broke at all. Pain is a shared human experience, and we all have the scars to prove it. And some of these scars linger long after the pain has subsided. As reminders, they're reminders of what we've been through and what we've gone through, what we've suffered. Now, some of us are ashamed of those scars and would rather cover up the brokenness because it reminds us of a far too painful past. Or we think others might reject us if they were to see us in all of our raw, naked brokenness. Millions of dollars are spent annually on various attempts to conceal our emotional and physical scars, sometimes even from ourselves. Yet these scars remain present and can show up when we least expect it, causing pain and confusion in both us and the ones we love. In many instances, the deepest wounds are those that are invisible, like spiritual or religious trauma, which often reside at the core of our being. But I'm here today to convey to you, your scars don't have to remain hidden. There is healing and hope available. Indeed, beauty can be found in your brokenness. The Japanese art Kintsugi that was talked about in this morning's story for all ages is the art of mending broken pottery with gold or other precious metals, which embodies the philosophy that broken objects once repaired can possess even greater beauty and value, not by restoring the objects to its original state, but by transforming it into something new. The inference here encourages us to highlight our imperfections, the broken pieces of our lives, which we would normally discard away with the trash, but rather highlight them as a thing of value, or shall I say, as beauty marks. And understand that sometimes it is in being broken that we truly discover our worth. The new thing of value exists not despite the brokenness, but because of it. What if we could view our brokenness, our scars, as enduring symbols of our resilience, renewal, and connectedness?
Might we live fuller, more authentic lives if we were to stay connected with our inner selves, embracing our past wounds along with the insights they bring. Yeah. John Mark Green wrote, "Beautiful are those whose brokenness gives birth to transformation and wisdom." Every broken piece of our lives, each scar has a story attached to it and a lesson to be learned. Some of these stories are painful, while others are not. Some are filled with shame, while others are a source of pride. How many times you'll see a war veteran talk about, "I got this scar here and I got this scar there." They're proud of their past experiences. So maybe you were able to find love again after a failed relationship, or you recovered after a bankruptcy or a difficult diagnosis, or you refused to repeat the childhood abuse that you endured, but rather you chose to overcome it. Somehow you made it through. When others thought you should have given up, you persevered, you hung in there. One of my scars stems from the fact that my father never told me or showed me, not even once in my life, that he loved me. In fact, I don't think he ever spoke those words to any of his children. So I'm very intentional with my daughter about telling and showing her that she is loved. And I chose to forgive my father by accepting the words he never spoke. Because perhaps he did feel love for us, but simply didn't know how to show it. We all must forgive both ourselves and others for the missteps along the way. Our wounds will remain open and oozing if we dare to refuse to forgive. This is a major part of our becoming something new. And above all, we must love. Love unconditionally. Love through the pain. Love in the face of fear and doubt. For it is love that ultimately heals all wounds and mends all brokenness. Folks, if love is a remedy and antidote to brokenness, then we need to be about love's business. I said, we need to be about love's business. We may not be able immediately to heal all the brokenness of the world with our love, but this should not diminish our efforts. In other words, we need to keep on loving the hell out of folks, despite how they show up in the world. This is the essence of our aspiration to love beyond belief. It is to see and honor the beauty in each other's brokenness and to bind individual broken pieces into a community. And we do this with the pure gold of our authentic presence, the sacred conversations that we must have, along with the acts of kindness and generosity and the strength of our shared humanity. This is how we get it done. Now, it would be remiss of me not to acknowledge the times when beauty is hard to find and recovery is not an option. Sometimes the mess is beyond mending, the hurt beyond healing, the brokenness beyond repair. Our limbs may be amputated. We may lose our sight. The cancer may metastasize. We and our loved ones may not survive. Yet, amidst all of our loss and struggles lies the power of choice, the choice to ascribe value to what remains in the aftermath of all our battles with brokenness, scars, and the elusive beauty of our existence. Although Miss Kors picked up the broken pieces of the porcelain mask she won at the auction, they weren't put back together. She didn't repair the mask. Rather, she accepted the broken pieces as they were. And the value was what she alone placed in them. Margaret Atwood stated, "In the end, we all become stories." It's a poignant reminder of our agency in crafting our own narratives, despite or perhaps because of our wounds. Some wounded individuals often find themselves shackled by the ghost of what should have been or what could have been, but this can stifle their ability to move forward. They are ensnared by the illusion that life is to be free of loss, failure, or injury, and we know that's not possible, right? But we allow our minds to trick us. Wounded individuals often find themselves shackled, but they can be set free. Maria Robinson insightfully remarked, "Nobody can go back and start a new beginning, but anyone can start today and make a new ending." This perspective isn't merely about moving past our brokenness, but about transcending it. The Apostle Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians 4 and 9 that we may be perplexed, but we are not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. This verse reminds us that our brokenness does not define us. Rather, it is a state from which we can rise, transformed by the grace of the divine, that source that sustains us all. While we may never reclaim the future we once envisioned before our trials, we have the unique capacity to reimagine the path we're on. Our stories, folks, are ours to tell. The beauty we seek then becomes not a quest for what was lost, but a celebration of what we have found in its stead. Strength, courage, wisdom, and the unwavering resolve to forge a new narrative of hope and possibility. When beloved All Souls member Rocky Stegman's courageous battle with cancer was nearing the end, a spark of hope shined through the overwhelming sense of despair. Rocky was a cherished professional at Channel 6 for a number of years and a well-known and well-loved persona in the community. His deep connection with his partner, Robin Ballinger, demonstrated the power of love and commitment, even in facing life's fragility. In Rocky's final days, he and his family received exceptional care, kindness, and compassion from nurse Kelly Scott and her team at St. Francis Hospital, who held them and guided them through each stage of the dying process. Kelly also attended to Rocky's young sons, Zach and Evan, with understanding and comfort. She went as far as counseling and staying in contact with his family in California, who was also struggling with accepting his pending death. Robin remarked, "Kelly made the experience beautiful." Profoundly touched by the support and empathy from Kelly Scott and her team during this most difficult of times, Robin was inspired to honor Rocky's legacy by giving back. Robin recounted reaching out to Kelly, asking if there was anything needed at St. Francis or if she knew of a way she could give back. "Well," said Kelly, "I have a dream. I dream of creating a sanctuary for those at the twilight of their lives, a place for people who can't keep their loved ones at home due to exhaustion, the presence of small children, or the lack of understanding about death, or for the many people who don't have the resources for their loved ones to remain at home." Robin told her how beautiful of an idea it was and that she wanted to help. And thus, a dream was put in motion. Among the first to seek solace within its embrace was Helen, whose husband could no longer care for his sick wife at home. Then another person came, and then another, and another. Initially, it was housed in a modest 3-bedroom apartment, but in response to the community's needs, it quickly expanded to a second apartment, ultimately leading to a capital campaign and efforts to build something more permanent. And through relentless dedication, communal efforts, and the generosity of multiple donors and a united vision of what end-of-life care can look like, land was purchased and construction began. And then around the year 2000, Clare House was fully realized. A peaceful refuge designed to offer families a place to come together, to learn and find comfort as they navigate the inevitability of their loved one's death. Born from brokenness, from the brokenness of Rocky's passing and a persistent dream of caring for the most vulnerable, Clare House has flourished into a legacy of beauty, a place where many of our church members have spent their final days, including our beloved ministers, Reverend John Wolfe and Bishop Carlton Pearson, who died last year. Clare House is an example of the impact that our lives can have even beyond our time on this earth, that even in brokenness, others can be inspired to repair, to mend, and to dream. A testament to the profound beauty that can arise from brokenness. Indeed, my friends, it is our brokenness that makes us truly human. And it is our brokenness that enables us to connect with others on a deeper level. Why? Because we can relate to one another's struggle, because we can support and help each other heal. So let us honor our shared brokenness and the resilience it reveals, finding beauty in our imperfections and unity in our collective journey toward wholeness, bound by the golden threads of our humanity. So let me end with the words of Laura Jean Truman. Keep my anger from becoming meanness. Keep my sorrow from collapsing into self-pity. Keep my heart soft enough to keep breaking. Keep my anger turned towards justice, not cruelty. Remind me that all of this, every bit of it, is for love. Keep me fiercely kind. I love you.
Just one more step. Just one more step. Our closing song together, we left blank, but as David and I were talking this morning, this bubbled up. It's number 168 in your hymnal. One more step, one more word, one more prayer. And especially for the choir members, one more song, and for you too, but our closing hymn is number 168, one more step.
may be seated. Wow, one more song. Yes, yes. It is one of our traditions to give our plate away to an organization in our community doing the good works of the world. We do this as a practice of living our values of love and service. So this week's offering is going to none other than Claire House. Yes. Now, their innovative non-medical model of care has served the community for over 20 years. They embrace death and dying as a normal part of life and provide it at no cost to the guests and families this service. They support people in need to make the most in every moment, and it's 24/7 that they're open. So as the offering plate comes around, please give generously. But I do have a few announcements. Now, if you're giving to the church, before I go to my announcements, there's a white envelope in the back, just in your pew back, for monies that will go to the church. Everything else will go to Claire House. So our announcements. Every Sunday is joining Sunday at All Souls. Now, today's session is at 12:45 in room 112. And this is an opportunity to meet an All Souls minister, ask questions, connect with others who are joining, and to become a member of this fantabulous church. I'm making up words, y'all. Okay. So today is also Selection Sunday for the NCAA basketball tournament, which means it is time to fill out your March Madness bracket. Choose your winning numbers, your winners, choose your winners, rather, and sign up. It's not a lottery, okay? Choose your winners and sign up to join the All Souls group for a share of the kitty, should they win. And also get your tickets now for this Friday's chili cook-off, dessert auction, and March Madness watch party. It's going to be so much fun, and I'm going to be a part of it. I'm going to be one of the judges. I'm eating a bunch of chili, folks. So you don't want to miss out on that. You can find more information in Emerson Hall or on our website. Also, all knitters, crocheters, quilters are wanted. And I wanted to show you something. The Shaw Ministry is meeting. And so for all of you fiber artists who make it a spiritual practice of creating shawls to give to people in our church and community who are in need of comfort and solace. They also make baby hats, blankets, booties, and more. And all are welcome. So if you even don't know how to crochet or knit, they will show you. So come. They meet every Wednesday at 7 p.m. in Thoreau Lounge. And this is some of the work that they created. Isn't it gorgeous? All right. Next Sunday, March 24th, is Heritage Sunday. So we'll celebrate our 103rd birthday. Now, we will have one service. It's at 10:30. So make sure you let everybody know it's one service at 10:30. And then afterwards, we'll have a reception in Emerson Hall. Now, shuttle service to and from the Bank of Oklahoma will be provided. And we do still need a couple of volunteers for that service. So after the service, if you're interested, please just tap me on the shoulder and say, I'll drive, Randy. I'm looking at all of you. All right. And then on March 31st, we will have our traditional Easter service at 10 a.m. with an Easter egg hunt at 11 a.m. And our humanist service will be at 11:30. A special communion service will also be held in the chapel at 11:30 as well. For further details and for all the other programming, please check your order of services. Now, in honor of St. Patrick's Day, the adult choir will sing the Old Irish Blessing as we gratefully receive our offering for Claire House. Thank you.
Shine warm upon your face, the rain.
Close. Remember, if you're a first-time guest with us, please invite you to a special meet and greet in the library that's outside the sanctuary doors to the left. And if you're online, please stay for our coffee hour conversations immediately after the service. And now Jeannie Lee will extinguish the flame of our chalice. We'll hear some words as you come down.
Holding the Light by Stuart Kestenbaum. Gather up whatever is glittering in the gutter, whatever has tumbled in the waves or fallen in flames out of the sky. For it's not only our hearts that are broken, but the heart of the world as well. Stitch it back together. Make a place where the day speaks to the night and the earth speaks to the sky. Whether we created God or God created us, it all comes down to this. In our imperfect world, we are meant to repair and stitch together what beauty there is. Stitch it with compassion and wire. See how everything we have made gathers the light inside itself and overflows. A blessing.
The love by which you live and the change you wish to see in the world. Until we meet again, go in peace, my friend. Let's go.